For science.
Hi, I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson, and this is Rising Stars. Today, we're featuring Rob Rhinehart, who's founder and CEO of Soylent, a meal replacement product that's all the rage in the tech universe. Rob, welcome.
Thank you very, very much for having me.
Soylent, how old were you when you started this?
24.
Your company's now valued at how, what's in the, like $100 million?
That was a few years ago. We've grown substantially since then.
That's crazy, crazy.
Food is a huge market.
So how did you get initial funding to do this? So did, were you using your savings to start this? Was in your garage?
We'd raised a small amount of capital from a startup incubator run founded by Paul Graham called Y Combinator. And then after we started to get off the ground a little bit, we used crowdfunding. We raised $3 million in a crowdfunding campaign.
Was it the word Soylent that was getting people?
It definitely stimulated some conversation.
You're too young to remember the original reference.
I'm a huge fan of the movie and the book.
Soylent Green.
Soylent Green.
What is the secret of Soylent Green?
Keeping that science aspect and that science fiction aspect is very important to me, because when you think of Soylent Green in the book, Make Room, Make Room, that's a very real problem about the population growth and burdening the Earth's resources. You know, I think we need to take these problems very seriously and catch them before they start.
So what are you trying to do here?
We're trying to make food better. We wanted to see what a balanced diet entails and then meet those requirements as elementally as possible.
So elementally, you mean sort of molecular nutritional level of the product?
Exactly. Goal was to use science to make improve the food system.
Whatever you put in here, you want to say it's better than like the whole meal I just had? I had like eggplant parmesan last night.
Well, it depends what you're optimizing for.
Optimized for pleasure, how about that?
This may not be the most pleasurable meal in the galaxy.
Okay.
However, it is very functional.
Functional food.
Right. Ever since food fortification from a generation ago, I mean, iodized salt, fortified rice, cereal, even macaroni and cheese has to be fortified.
Yeah, yeah, it's all, you know, all the grains.
Nutritional deficiencies used to be just part of life, and now they're gone.
They're gone completely.
Just gone.
This is an engineering problem.
Right.
A food engineering problem.
Food engineering problem, and it's a very complex problem. I mean, it's pretty astounding that we can make something like this that will sit on a shelf without refrigeration for a year.
Is the food you want in the zombie apocalypse?
Exactly. Preppers love this stuff.
So can I try your liquid here?
You can.
So this, what, how do I know what flavor this is?
We were trying to have something kind of neutral, kind of bland.
So you managed to create this and not have much of a taste. It's really a perfunctory
which is very difficult, because every one of those ingredients does have a taste.
Right.
So to have something ending up neutral is much, much more difficult than to have something that tasted strongly of, say, mint.
So this will define forevermore what Soylent tastes like for me.
Yes.
Okay, here we go. A little, some of it reminds me of kaopectate.
For diarrhea, you take kaopectate.
This doesn't have the same function.
Here's what you do. You know what it is? The urge to participate in this brilliant exercise in food is not bigger than wanting this to taste awesome.
You know, we have another flavor. We have coffeeist. You want to try that?
Okay, we'll try some. See, that's way better. I don't know what this is. Maybe I want a taste, that's what it is. You put so much energy taking taste out of this. Then why am I doing it? This tastes like a room temperature coffee milkshake.
Because first we had to take taste out of everything else in there so that we could add in something.
So there'd be new, a pure thing.
And it would only taste like what we put in there, not all the previous stuff.
This tastes like a coffee milkshake, you did it.
I think he likes it.
So what's your science background? Because you can't just walk into this saying I want new food and not understand chemistry and physiology.
Personally, I actually studied more electrical engineering and computer science.
Mm-hmm. This in college?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Are you a rare entrepreneur who actually graduated from college?
I did graduate from college.
I'm
so
disappointed.
I know I lose a lot of credit.
Yeah, yes. You know, I don't know, you know, no. So what all it meant was that college did not homogenize your creativity.
I suppose not.
And so once you have the engineering background, you're science geeked out anyway, and then you just absorb the rest of what you need to know.
Always love learning, always love studying, and I realized that I don't need to take a class on something to learn it.
Yeah, it's and I think what a revelation that is.
Right.
That works only when you've learned how to learn.
I wish I got more educators like you.
I have it easy because I just look at a camera lens. You know, I'm not there with the screaming kids.
No, but you're
when I see an actual teacher, it's like, oh, I'm not worthy.
No, but you were like the world's coolest teacher. You know that. You must know
No,
that.
I got good material. The universe is good material. Is this the future of food? Or is this something to get us thinking new ways about food?
The process by which this was designed is a big component of the future of food. That we need to start thinking really seriously about what the body needs and how food is produced.
Until now, we just thought about what the body needs, and we just combed the earth to put the stuff in here. See, now you've got this, but I use 10 acres of land, 3 cows, 4 quarts of milk, whatever. And you got the full, as you would say, the vertical integration of the production of this in mind.
Exactly.
You think that's the future?
Absolutely. Eventually, I'd like to get to the point, and I'm focusing on protein right now, to produce everything with single-celled organisms. Calories comes from the sun at some point. Plants take the sun's energy. Then if you feed those plants to an animal, then you get the energy that ends up in its meat or fat. But
right, a cow is just a machine to turn sunlight into steak.
You can see it that way.
Right? It's exactly. That's the only
but
point of a cow.
A lot of energy is lost along the way. Mm-hmm. So the more directly you can extract that energy from the sun, the better.
So is this one meal or one whole day's worth of?
We're not quite there yet. Eventually we'd like to get to a pill.
I mean, there's a limit to how many calories you can cram in a certain volume of the space-time continuum.
There is, but maybe if we had some sort of radioactive isotope that in an engineered strain of gut bacteria to extract the energy from that, and then that therein synthesizes the carbohydrate and fat and protein that you need.
So you're actually thinking about this?
Oh, absolutely.
So we would, since we currently, and we evolved to be 100% chemical energy driven. In this model, part of us would be tapping nuclear energy.
It's certainly possible. Maybe you wouldn't even need to swallow the pill. You could fit enough energy in a tiny seed that maybe you could implant the isotope and then the bacteria could feed off of that for a century.
Presumably you wouldn't otherwise get cancer from
it. You'd shield it.
Okay. Holding aside that minor complicate, you're dead from cancer in a week, but you're otherwise really healthy.
But you're very well fed.
I imagine a day, as long as we're making stuff up here, where we understand the genome of every species, recognize the commonality among us all, and figure out a way to turn some patches of our skin into photosynthetic surfaces. If you had an ideal surface on your skin to absorb sunlight, it should be completely black. And somewhere under there, you put in
I guess you would need a few photosensitive proteins. Like, you have blue-green algae, which not just uses chlorophyll, but also phycocyanin.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So,
because they had their run of Earth 4 billion years ago.
Still going strong. Not what they used to be.
Yeah, they're not. They used to be in charge of the Earth.
Those were the days.
They gave us all our oxygen.
The sulfur.
We are not the biggest changers of the Earth's climate. Those bacteria were.
Another thing, speaking of the genome, is that you could, in theory, we could synthesize our own vitamins.
Why? How come we can't grow limbs, but newts can?
And why do we need some amino acids we can't make?
Or what is it, we can't digest cellulose, and most of the plant life in the world is cellulose?
Yeah, you could either have cellulitic gut bacteria.
Then we'd have way more methane flatulence.
And then cook it on your stove.
The future of food. So you got the whole closed loop. Well, it sounds like you have just the right kind of background to think that creatively. If you had only a pure biology background, maybe you wouldn't have come to some of these revelations.
Maybe not.
The engineer thinks about a problem and how to solve it.
And I think a great engineer or a scientist sees that the boundaries between the fields are not absolute.
Right. And you just cross them over whenever you need to.
Yeah, that chemical energy, electrical energy.
Just energy.
It's the same.
It's energy. So what's next? You just can keep growing the company, be a zillionaire, and then help the UN.
Absolutely.
Feed the world.
We can help feed the world. And in time, I think we'll invest in the science and technology, vertically integrate food production, such that you can have an at-home bioreactor that will print nutritious food directly from sunlight, air, and water.
At-home bioreactor.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. You got to go drop an octave. Like George Takei. Oh, my.
Oh, my. Oh my.
Oh yeah. Yeah!
So that's it's fascinating, the future of food. $2, under $3.
That's a little over $3. This is under $3.
You're out of control.
Best is yet to come.